ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
Hey guys, we're live here, the Prince of Investing, which I'm your host, Prince Dykes, coming all the way live from the beautiful state of Denver, Colorado, even though right now we're live in Hawaii. But you guys stay tuned. You guys keep it locked right here, right now. We're going to another amazing, great episode, and we still haven't gotten canceled. So this is the thing, guys. As you guys can see in the description box, we have a very, very great topic today. For wherever you're catching us from, if you're catching the playback or you're catching the live feed, podcast, or whatever it may be, we're going to be talking about the next market crash. What is the next market crash? When it possibly can be happening? This is a big question on everybody's mind. So we're going to be talking about that. And I got a very, very special guest. If you're a fan of the show and you've been following the show, you've seen him on here a couple times. You know, of course, I had to bring in a very special guest, 40-year Wall Street veteran, James Foytlin. He's calling in. He's seen some great times, some bad times in his career, being an investment advisor, being right there on Wall Street. So that's a lot of expertise. We're going to come in with that topic. So you guys keep it locked. And as always, I don't have a lot of time. I definitely know you guys and girls don't have a lot of time. So we're going to jump straight into it. So without further ado, let me introduce my guest. Mr. Foytlin, how is it going, sir?
How are you today?
I'm doing outstanding. We know you all the way. You're in New Jersey, you know, right there, by Wall Street. You're on Wall Street all the time, spend so much time there. And I know you give amazing tours because I took one there 2 years ago myself when I was on Wall Street. And you have a lot of history, a lot of knowledge of Wall Street. And I noticed that you were saying that the number one question you always ask is people are saying, when is the next market crash? Right, because you give that financial crisis tour, people are wondering when is the next one. What do you have to say about that?
I would say right now I hear that question more than any other time since I've had anything to do with the business. And I don't know whether it's because the media is so negative or whether it's because people see guys like Ray Dalio, who's a very famous investor, a billionaire, and he's always on TV saying, this reminds him of 1938 and things like that. I think that scares a lot of people. I'm not sure the reason, but this is what I get all the time. And what I'm here tonight really to talk to you about is to tell people that, yeah, the market goes in cycles. And, yeah, we're going to have a crash, and we're probably, you know, we've had – I remember 87. I remember 2000. I remember 2008. I've been through a bunch of them, and I've been through some minor ones. People even older than me can tell me stories about the 70s, like in the middle of the 70s during the oil embargo and during Watergate. There were also sort of crashes or really bad markets. What a lot of people are worried about now is they hear, oh, we have a lot of debt, interest rates are coming back up. I think mortgage rates hit a 7-year high. People are concerned that the Federal Reserve had been printing a lot of money for a while to get us out of the 2008 crisis. And now they're starting to sop up or sort of slow down their printing. I hear talk about the sort of an inverse yield curve where the short-term rates are higher than the long-term rates. But I'm here tonight really to try to reassure people. First of all, what you have to do is you got to look at any market declines as opportunities. In the long run, for most non-professional investors, if you just ride the market out and you keep a regularly reinvesting or dollar cost averaging, like I hear you talk about all the time, I think you have very little to worry about. It's like, you know, you go to Macy's and that coffee pot you want is on sale. Well, it looks a lot better at $30 than it did at $150. And this is what, unfortunately, with the stock market, this is what people get scared and they don't act or they stop acting. I would say right now, the way it looks to me is we're still working out the effects of 2008. A lot of people call it a credit crisis or a real estate crisis. I think more credit. I think it was just a credit crunch was more to some degree. It was like a breakdown in the entire credit system. And I think that we have a lot of hangover from that time. That when President Obama came in at first, I think he was trying to reassure people and make people feel confident and make people feel safe. And you know, as I do, like, safety often eliminates a lot of opportunities. And so we had a kind of a very flat market. Yeah, people will go, oh, well, from the low, it was up this much or whatever. But the reality is the market really didn't move a whole lot for probably, you know, really about 10 years. It didn't move a whole lot. Now we have a new regime in town with some new ideas. And we're trying to unwind a lot of the problems from 2008. And so there's a lot of deregulation. There's been some tax cuts. Yes, interest rates. The Fed is right now very concerned. This is another thing that I think scares people all the time. Every time they have a Fed governor on TV, the Fed governor says, well, the market, the economy is racing along and we have very low unemployment and it's putting a lot of inflationary pressures and we're going to have to start raising interest rates to kind of slow things down. And I'm here tonight to kind of like dissuade a lot of these things. First of all, with unemployment, you have to remember we had a big level of non-participation in the workforce, probably the highest level of non-participation since the 1970s. And now with a lot of millennials, because they grew up in kind of a recessionary environment, they're very slow to turn to the workforce. So what I might have done when I was 16 or younger, I had a paper route, then I cut lawns, then eventually, you know, I was a kid and I worked a lot and did things. For a lot of millennials, they're like, they're doing that when they're 24 or 25 instead of 17 and 18. Mm. And I'm not trying to be negative on millennials. It's just a different time. And I think they're just going into the environment. I grew up during the 70s. Things were bad during the 70s. And probably a lot of my peers did not get involved. And they were also late to go into the workforce because there weren't jobs. And it was like a hard time. And it was, things weren't great. I grew up a little different because I kind of was in a situation where I had to have money. So I just needed to work. It didn't, none of these things were really that relevant. So that's one. The other thing is interest rates, like we see them going up a bit. Let's face it, they were below the mean. They were very low for a very long time, lower than the mean has been for probably the last 50 years. And by them raising now, we're only coming right back into like the norm, and we're still really not there yet. So I'm not really sure that interest rate increase is going to have the impact. You also see, you hear a lot about the Fed unwinding its balance sheet, which is a really fancy way for to say that they're not going to print as much money anymore, basically. And I think that when you go through a period of a lot of, you know, printing money like crazy, because that was the only tool, they were basically throwing money at people and hoping people would spend it. Unfortunately, when they do that, the net cost usually is that the money goes into the stock market. It kind of inflates financial assets get inflated, really. I think that also is creating some unusual circumstances with the yield curve. A lot of people are very concerned about this inverse. So what does that mean? When long-term rates are lower, because in the long run, they perceive a weaker economy coming. But in the short term, rates start to go up because they're trying to slow the cool off. The Fed always uses these euphemistic words. They say, well, we're trying to cool off the economy. And I just think that we went through a period of you know, basically 10, 12 years where you had no growth in income for most people. In fact, you had a decline probably in income.
I had a one question. When you said, when you're speaking about the yield rates, right, the 2 year to 5 year to 10 year, why do they advertise and everything? Why are the yield rates so important to the stock market? Why do I need to see this?
Well, in the long run, you got to remember a lot of borrowing money and the ability to borrow money inexpensively. Like, for example, if I'm short of money, now this probably wouldn't happen too much. It happens, but it still happens once in a while. Something might happen. I'm a little short. What do? I say, hey, Mom, can I borrow $10? Right. But if General Motors is, you know, needs money, they have to borrow money on a huge scale. And the price of that money, when it gets more expensive, it digs into their profits. And then it also may dig into their decision, because they may say, hey, at this level of interest rate, we can't make the return, so it's not worth reopening that factory in Detroit, which would hire hundreds and hundreds of people. We're going to put that off for another couple of years until it's ready. If rates are low, there's this view that, hey, it's cheap to borrow. The risk premium is lower. It's much less risk for me to borrow that money and then open that factory up and start making cars there. And so it's often, I think a lot of novice investors get very wrapped up in this stuff, because if you watch like CNBC and things, they harp on all this all the time. For most of us, what's the issue? The real issue is to spend less money than we make and to take that difference and put it, you know, invest it into our future. And for a lot of people, that means buying stocks. And for a lot of us, what do? We make a plan. Well, what really makes that successful or not successful is whether we follow through with that plan. If I say every month I'm going to put $100 in the stock market and buy an index fund, I need to stick with that rain or shine. Whether those interest rates go up or down, go ahead.
Now, James, on a question I have before, a listener that's listening right now, they're like, okay, well, I'm a novice investor. I'm looking to invest. Okay, this market is going to crash. So what if I just wait until the crash comes? Then I'll just buy in. What do you have to say to that person?
Well, first of all, like when you hear guys like there's a lot of like I see these guys and I get very frustrated. Like you've visited, you went to Berkshire and you know you see Warren Buffett and he's the man. But when a guy has $1 billion, he looks at things a lot different than when you have $100 in your checking account. Like, I got to pay the rent at the end of every month, and so do a lot of people. Warren Buffett, like, is kind of beyond that because he's made a certain amount of money. So he worries about, you know, whether his steak is medium rare. Like, you know, he's got other issues.
Yeah.
And so he gives a lot of advice based on the idea. I have so many people when I was a broker used to say, well, that's great for Warren Buffett. He has $1 billion. He can hold his stock for 15 years. I got to pay college tuition for my kids in 2 years. What am I going to do? But I think for a smaller novice investor, right, when you start going at the beginning, the reality is if you miss, like a lot of people, you hear this thing, oh, if you miss the 10 best days in 10 years, your return is greatly decreased. Well, when you're dealing with smaller amounts of money, a lot of that doesn't make a whole lot of difference. And I would postulate that if you miss, if you're a really bad timer and you miss the 10 best days and you miss the 10 worst days all at the same time, you'll probably end up with a pretty decent return over the long run. It's not going to make a whole lot of difference. And a lot of the really good, like when I looked back at the numbers and you humanize them, for example, after the 87 stock market crash in 87, what were the 10 best days in 87? Well, three of them came 2 weeks after the stock market crashed in 87. Okay, and then you were almost back. You weren't quite back to the lows on the Dow, but you were pretty low once again, even after the market drifted back down again because it reconsolidated before it finally got going. So for a lot of investors, like smaller investors, don't outsmart yourself. The game is in the plan. And you know what? If the market crashes tomorrow, things are a lot cheaper. That $100, I think I was telling you one time when I was on here, I had a stock that in 1987 was $177 a share, and it paid a huge, it paid about a 4.5-5% dividend. Okay, I reinvested the dividend, and I was in a stock purchase plan for that bank. When the market crashed in 87, that stock went to $7. And the dividend was $4. It was huge. And guess what? I didn't know any better because it was too much of a hassle to pick up the phone and slow down the dividend reinvestment plan. I just left it. I didn't bother. I didn't even fool around. I didn't even look at it. And you know what? When it paid those dividends, it bought a lot of shares. But within 6 months, that stock was all the way back up to $180 a share. And the time when it was way down, the amount of shares I added was for me at the time was an enormous amount of leverage. And then that stock went up and up, and after that it went up and up and up and up, and eventually it got taken over by another bank. And it was like you got to be when you're a new investor or an inexperienced investor, and some people always say it's time in the market. To me, it's even simpler than that. It's stick with the plan, create a plan, and stick to it, and don't let anything rain.
And like you said, that's great. I definitely agree with that. Get in with the plan, whether even if you got with the index and just, you know, had the dividends reinvested. But the thing about it is, a person that you mentioned in the beginning, Ray Dalio, people read Ray Dalio's latest book, Principles, and they say, wow, he's like one of the most successful hedge funds managers of our time.
The guy's a genius. The guy's a total genius. He's a genius.
And, you know, I'm, you know, reading his book, Principles, lately, you know, as of now. But let's say if he turns around, he says, hey, I got 40% of this market, and I'm doing this great. People are like, well, I want those returns. That's what I think investment is. What would you say to that guy?
I would tell people that, you know, what again, and I bring this up all the time, this has become sort of my mantra in the business. You get many people who get a very hot hand through certain market cycles. And you might get really smart guys like Ray Dalio who might even go 20 years as a hot hand. When I started, or when I first learned about the stock market, there was a guy named Robert Prechter. Robert Prechter made a chart in the 60s that charted the Dow all the way up to 1987, and he was within 20 points every single day that whole entire period. I mean, that's a long run. That's over 20 years. And then the market crashed in 87, which he predicted. But then he never got on the horse again. He was never as good as he was before the crash. So it's hard to find a guru. Yeah, you can find a guy like Buffett, but let's face it. I mean, when I look at Buffett and I look at some of his companies, I say, wow, he's a brilliant guy. He's a very smart investor. There's a lot more going on than what he, like this folksy sort of buy and hold, and I own a lot of stock and I just sit with it and I buy things I know. Well, I know a few things, and I know when I see stocks, companies like Gillette, which he owns a lot of, they charge $30 for a razor blade. I'm not buying a $30 razor blade no matter what. So if I'm not buying it, I think a lot of other people aren't going to buy it. And I can afford to buy a $30 razor blade, but there's no way I'm going to buy it. It's not even in the realm of possibilities. And so sometimes I see things and I say, well, in the long run, that might end up being a problem. Maybe not in my lifetime, but eventually it might catch up to, or it may not. They may adjust. Somebody at Gillette may say, these razor blades are really great, but they are kind of expensive. Maybe we got to figure this out. We might be pricing ourselves out of our own market. And not because they're not great razor blades, because they are. They really are great razor blades. But it's just I can get one that's slightly, like a little, not quite as good for 1/10 of the price. And so what I see is what you really should look at is, well, it's hard to find somebody like Buffett that's almost always right in the long run or right, you know, continuously for 20, 30 years. You can always find a lot of people who are wrong every single minute of every single day. And so for small investors, what I would do is I just watch what you see. If everybody says the market, first of all, markets don't crash and they get announced ahead of time on CNBC. There's a guy named Jim Rogers, who I often don't agree with stuff he says, yet he's another very smart long-termer and been very successful. And he always says that the next catastrophe comes from someplace you totally don't expect. Like in 2008, what really triggered it? Iceland went bankrupt. Most people I know don't even know where Iceland is, let alone they didn't know Iceland had a bank. They didn't know Iceland had a stock market. They didn't know Iceland, like, they don't know anything about it. They think there's a few volcanoes and it's a little cold. They don't know anything about it. So these things always come from places you don't expect. So instead of worrying about things that you have no control over, focus on things you have control over, which is regular reinvesting, which I can put $100 a month every way, or $200 or $500 or whatever it is, right? And and then also just recognize, or like, look at the media. They're the perfect barometer for what not to do. What did they say on election night? Hillary Clinton was going to win by a landslide. That didn't quite work out the way we expected, right? Then they said Trump's going to get elected, the market's going to crash. It was up 6,000 points in 13 months. Another winning prediction. And I'm not trying to promote Trump. I'm just saying, look at the media. They're like your weather vane for what not to do. Like, if they're telling you the market's going to crash, I would probably be buying like crazy. To me, the more negative they are, the more positive I am. What my barometer right now is, what I watch every day, is the day that CNN announces that they love Donald Trump is the day I'm going to sell everything and leave the country. Then I know it's over. Then the market really is going to crash. Because they're so anti, and they've just continually been wrong. So like, they're wrong. Their batting average is like 1,000%. Like we used to say on Wall Street, even a broken clock is right twice a day. They're not even right twice a day. They're never right.
So I got a question, right?
Go ahead.
If as a small investor, and you know another market is going to crash, is going to happen, what would you do? Or what would you say? Hey, is there some ways I can prepare for it? Would you recommend taking some money, hiding it in bonds? Would you kind of like, hey, sit on some cash in order to be able to take advantage of the down market? Is there anything that you would say to, like, hey, well, is there a way I can kind of move around my portfolio as an investor to prepare for another, you know, down time?
Well, I would always, first of all, when you first start, you want to build up an emergency fund. I think almost everybody will tell you that. So you want to have that extra money, whether it's because you need new tires on your car or because the market crashes. That's an emergency. Some people would tell me going out on vacation to Hawaii would be an emergency. That sounds like a pretty good emergency to me, but I haven't quite pulled the trigger on that one. But so you need, that's first. And what I would do is, if you see these huge sell-offs, you might say, hey, this month, or you know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to have my Starbucks every day for a month. That's going to save me what? A couple hundred bucks right there. So you can generate that money if you really have to in the short run. Maybe I don't want to give up Starbucks every day for the whole year, but for 60 days, I could not have my Starbucks. I could rough it. And I'll just go and I'll just make coffee at home, and I'm not going to have my fancy Starbucks. And look at all the money I'd save, right? There's my extra $200 to throw on a market or whatever. I think you have to just be convinced. For example, we all know that we're eventually going to die, right? And what happens if you die tomorrow? Well, that would really be bad. I wouldn't want that to happen. I wouldn't wish that on anybody. But it could happen. But yeah, I'd say the probability is not that high. That's the same way you look at a market crash. Yeah. I'm sure we're going to have another market crash. Is it going to be tomorrow? I doubt it. Is it going to be in the next 8 years? Probably. Is it going to be terrible? Is it going to be like 87 where we're going to recover from, be terrible and recover? Or is it going to be like 2008 where it's going to kind of drag and drag? I don't know. I'm not sure yet. But as an investor, we have no control over that. So why worry about it? I can only look, what I can control is my long-term goals. I know what I want. I know that in 10 years, Hawaii is one of the only states I've never been to, so I'm going to go to Hawaii within the next 10 years. That's one of my goals. It's not going to happen tomorrow. It might even be the next time we do a show, I might be there. Or I might go to Colorado and visit you there. I was actually there last year at this time. So I was there. I was there before you were. Yeah. I went on I was invited to a conference. I went to the conference. And I spent a whole week in Denver. And so I was there.
Wow.
But hey, so, but it like I just think you got to look at it that way. Like I had a friend who a former business partner. He was probably pushing 70, but he was in really good shape. He worked out. He ate right. He drank and did stuff, but always moderation. He was always very good. He was very health conscious his whole life. And what happens? Out of the blue, he gets cancer and he dies like in 2 weeks. And
wow.
But you never, like, on the other hand, I know people who live to be over 100. And they smoke a cigar every day, and they drink a martini every day, and yeah, they were in okay health, but they really never gave too much thought about it, and they just lived their life, and they did whatever they had to do, and they did the best they could. And you know what? Like, I'm somebody, if you say, hey, tomorrow, you're going to lose a lot of your money, you're not going to have much money. When I was younger, there's been times in my life I haven't had any money, so I just adapt. And then there's other times when I have a lot more money. So, but I like you just have to be brave. You have to have a little faith like that you're going to live tomorrow. You have to have a little faith that your investments in the long run are going to work out. And if you look at the numbers over 100 years, with all the ups and downs, the returns are pretty decent. I mean, there's no other way. And I just think trying to market time, especially when you're trying to match yourself against people like Ray Dalio. You're not. He's genius land.
Now, Jay, I understand. We have this type of question. Well, if you're saying, hey, just take my money and throw it into the index, what's the purpose of an investment advisor?
Oh, well, that's a good question. Well, a lot of times a good investment advisor is the guy who calls you up and says, listen, the market's down. You need to buy more stock. Don't be a fool. Don't chicken out. And when you call screaming, go, oh, my God, my stock is down. I want to sell everything. I'm going to run away and hide. He says, no, don't do it. That's his purpose. More than anything, his purpose is to hold your hand. And think of it this way. When something goes wrong, you can blame it all on him. And then when things go right, you can say, look how smart I am. I'm going to be like Warren Buffett, right?
So exactly.
He's got a very important role there. But a good investment advisor is going to be somebody who's going to, grab your hand and pull you in those tough times and say, listen, don't give up the ship. We can do this. And I can tell you in 87, people were calling me up, telling me they were going to kill me. And like, they were ready to go for it.
Wow. And,
and yet we survived. And then 6 months later, those same people were hugging me and buying me boxes of cigars because suddenly everything was back up. And like, there was love everywhere. There was so much love, I couldn't take it.
What's your favorite state?
My favorite state? Oh, boy.
Your favorite cigar.
Oh, my favorite cigar. I'm kind of a wimpy cigar smoker, so I generally err towards the mild stuff. So usually things with a Connecticut wrapper that are kind of mild, like those Macanudos are great. I mean, yeah, I've smoked Cuban cigars, and I smell like before they were lit. But I used to have a cigar company as a client, and so I used to smoke a lot of hand rolled stuff. I don't do it as much anymore, but you can still find those places in New York, and it's really cool. See somebody make your cigar for you and then you smoke it. That's one of the coolest things. And I like the socializing, because if you go and smoke a cigar anywhere in the world, whether I'm in Hawaii, I'm in Colorado, I'm in New Jersey, I'm in New York, you can go into a cigar place, light up a cigar, and guys you'll bond with everybody in there. Like, it's this weird, like, we all smoke cigars, and especially nowadays, it's kind of evil. So you're kind of like in this little club, like giggling about how you're smoking cigars and everybody in the world thinks you're terrible people and stuff. It's kind of, it's like anything else. Like, if I thought I was going to smoke a cigar and die tomorrow, yeah, I wouldn't do it. But in the long run, I smoke one or two a month. It's not really that big of a deal. At least it doesn't appear to be a big deal. Now, of course, if I get sick, I may say otherwise, right? As an investor, it's the same thing.
Uh-huh.
You got.
I want to ask, before we get out of here, we got to get rolling, because it's that time again. But what is something that you would like to leave with everyone out there?
What is some advice, you know, to that person or the people that's going to come and, you know, take the tour on Wall Street, the financial crisis tour, that's asking you that question? What is something you want to reiterate to them that you want them to take away?
Oh, they come to visit me and they do the tour, right? What you need to do is you study old crises, and then it helps you deal with the present day crisis. The crisis from 2008 is not going to be repeated. It's going to be a different crisis. But if you know a lot about it, it's the same things happened as in 2008 as with tulip bulbs in the 1780s. It was the same thing. And interesting enough, there was actually a banking crisis in 1792, and Alexander Hamilton led the first bank bailout, and it was very much done the same way that we handled 2008. And so once in a while, you do get a repeat, but not that often. And I think for most people, if you learn, then you feel, you say, okay, I know what's going to happen. Too much speculation, overinvestment, things going to blow up. That's bound to happen. When it happens, this is how I'm gonna keep my head cool. I'm gonna put my head down, and I'm gonna just fly right through this and just stick to the plan. And I'm gonna come out of this thing smelling like a rose. If I panic and get out like in '87, you only lost money if you sold the stocks, right? If you didn't sell the stock and you waited 6 months, you were like nothing ever happened. In fact, you were probably ahead of where you were at the top. You're already a new high. So I think my point is, like, again, I'm going to go back to this thing. We don't think we're going to die tomorrow. The same goes for investing. We don't think the market's going to crash tomorrow. It might, but I doubt it. So we have to take every day on faith. We can only control what we can control. I can only control what I can put in the market every week. I can only control what goals I have. I can focus on your career, make more money, invest more money, like focus on your life, take care of your wife, your girlfriend, your kids, like focus on that stuff. That investing gives you the opportunity to do more of those things.
So, James, as always, thanks for having you on. Thanks for you coming in. As always, guys, this is The Investing Show. I'm your host, Prince Dykes, coming all the way live from the beautiful state of Denver, Colorado. Until the next video, podcast, or cartoon, or whatever you see me do crazy around the globe, peace, be safe, I'm out, and thank you.